Let me just move to the sides and make sure I don't blow your ears out being next to the other speakers up here. Okay, good. All right. Let's open in a word of prayer before we begin our sermon this morning. Heavenly Father, gracious Lord above, may your Spirit now descend upon this place and upon each heart and mind to open us, Father, to the message you have prepared. May we hear, may we understand by the power of your Spirit that which you have longed to tell each of us. And may we go forth from this place blessed, Lord, ready to serve in your name. And it is in your name that we ask these things. Amen. So we're going to try something a little different this week. We have a video I'd like to show you at various points in the sermon. So if you are ready up above there, we'll give this a try. And don't hit play just yet. I need a little setup here. Can everybody see that okay? Does anybody recognize what they're seeing? Somebody likes it. I know the young people like it. So as you've heard me say before, I am a sci-fi geek, okay? I grew up watching Star Trek from age 6 and have gone through science fiction ever since. And one of the sci-fi things that I have enjoyed, though not as much as Star Trek, is Star Wars. And in one of the Star Wars movies, there is this little clip that really struck me about the power of faith and the power of trusting in God to get things done. And this section of the clip is where the hero of the piece, Luke Skywalker, is learning to use what is known as the Force. And so he's training on this particular planet, and he had gotten to this planet in his spaceship, but he ended up crashing it into a swamp, and it is sitting in a swamp, half submerged, and he is there with his instructor, this little green guy about a foot and a half high, and they're going through some training. And while they're going through this training, in the background, his ship is beginning to sink into the swamp, which would be very bad, because he wouldn't be able to get home if it were sunk. So that's where we pick up this part of the clip. We're going to go a little ways through it, pause it, and then we'll see a little bit more at the proper time. So hopefully we got Sam. And...
we'll never get it out now.
So certain are you. Always with you, it cannot be done. Do you nothing that I say?
Master, moving stones around is one thing. This is totally different.
No, no different. Only different in your mind. You must unlearn what you have learned.
All right, I'll give it a try.
No, try not. Do or do not. There is no try.
Possible.
We'll come back to that a little later. Turn with me, if you will, to John chapter 14, beginning in verse 12. Jesus, speaking to his disciples, says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do. And greater works than these will you do, because I am going to the Father. And whatever you ask in my name, this I will do." How often have you heard those words, folks? Prayed in Jesus' name and felt like Luke Skywalker in this video, where he just gets dejected, goes over, sits down, hangs his head. We've all read about the amazing miracles that take place in the Bible. The crossing of the Red Sea, David and Goliath, Daniel in the lion's den, Jonah and the whale, Lazarus being raised from the dead, the healing of the leper, the feeding of the 5,000. But let's be honest, when was the last time you actually witnessed something miraculous as that happen in your own life? Perhaps you've fallen into the trap of believing that those types of miracles were only for the people of the Old Testament or in Jesus' day, but not for us in the 21st century. David Watson was a student at Ashland Theological Seminary who felt the call to go to Nigeria as a Bible translator along with his future wife. And soon after they arrived, he found out that he was totally unprepared to deal with the people there in that area. They considered something to be very important in their lives, but they felt that Christianity really had no impact in it. They were keenly aware of the reality of the spirit world and its impact on their lives. They claimed that the source of disruption in their lives, from crop failure to disease, were the work of evil spirits. The Nigerians noticed that missionaries often taught about the power of God as being able to deal with such things. Things like tragedy, infertility, relational breakdowns, troublesome weather. But they also knew that whatever power Christianity claimed to have was inadequate to deal with these types of problems. Still, they found some good things about Christianity to embrace, such as acceptance, forgiveness of sins, love, and a relationship with Jesus Christ. But when it came to the power of the gospel to deal effectively with their problems, they learned not to expect anything. They had observed the way Western missionaries in their midst chose first to rely on technology and medicine rather than seek God's power to intervene and help them. Though the love of Christ shown by the missionaries was impressive, many wondered why they should abandon their old ways for a powerless gospel. Does that sound depressing? Doesn't it sound like Christianity should have something more powerful? Doesn't it sound like Christianity should be the answer and the solution to all problems? Do we believe that? Are you sure? You see, ministering in power is an integral part of Jesus' ministry and that of his disciples. Just read the book of Acts to see the power of the Holy Spirit at work in their midst. 3,000 came to faith in Christ on the day of Pentecost. One day. Could you imagine 3,000 people suddenly coming into this sanctuary? 2 Timothy 1:7 through 8 says, "For God did not give us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, of love and self-discipline. So do not be ashamed to testify about our Lord. As I look around at many of the churches of our day, I have to admit what I see is a spirit of fear. I do not see the power of the Scriptures that we claim to believe in having much effect. What we need is a fresh wind of the Holy Spirit to come and blow through us and transform us into these type of people. The Bible tells us that it's possible. The Bible tells us that it is God's will that we should go out in power to proclaim the gospel. But what's happening? As we read through the Scriptures, what do we find? Consider the passage we began with in this sermon. Many times people cherry pick what they like in the Bible. They don't tend to read the context before and after the verses to see what's going on. People think they know what the passage is saying. All I have to do to have my prayers answered is to pray using Jesus' name, as if Jesus' name were some sort of magic charm that we'd wave around and things would happen. But if we read a little further, he said, "Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do." But we did not read the whole passage because Jesus clarified that statement a moment later. You see, our ears hear that in Jesus' name and we stop there because that's easy. That means we don't have to think too hard. That means we don't have to do something. But what Jesus said immediately after that is he said, "Anything you ask in my name, I will do that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you, as we learned last week." And just who is this helper? Jesus mentions what he does for us. We read the answer to that question in Ephesians 1, 13, and 14, which we have seen several times before. "And you were also included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having been sealed with a mark, the promised Holy Spirit." In the video, the Jedi Master Yoda tells Luke, "Always with you, it cannot be done." Why is it that we feel disillusioned and frustrated over unanswered prayers? Is it because we have been praying for what we want? Remember that the Father may be glorified. James 4:3 says, "You do not have because you do not ask." Now, wait a minute, Bruce. We ask. Of course we ask. We pray all the time. We just don't seem to receive. And we continue to pray, and things don't seem to happen when we want them to. Does that sound about right? Now, wait a minute. James says this, "You do not receive because you do not ask, because you ask wrongly to spend it on your passions." A lot of our prayers, especially in our early Christian life, go like this: "Gimme, gimme, gimme." When we come to the Lord, it's "Gimme, gimme, gimme." We have this big roll of paper we roll out with our request, And we tell the Lord, I want this, I want that. Oh, by the way, I need it by 9 a.m. sharp on Thursday next week. As if God was our secretary, running around doing our bidding. But how often have we honestly and sincerely, deep down in our hearts, with no other motive, prayed for the Father to be glorified in what we ask for? When have we said, Lord, you be glorified? Think about that concept for a moment. You may remember a few weeks ago, we weren't in this area of the church. We were next door. And it was what Sunday? Anybody remember? Oh, yeah, Super Bowl Sunday. Look at how quickly we forget. And of course, we're trying to figure out, should we pray for the Patriots or should we pray for the Eagles? And we know that God doesn't really take sides. There's only one side, God's side. And one of the things I said was, let's pray that the Lord would be glorified in this. And when the coach got up at the end and he was receiving the trophy, one of the newscasters asked him on national television, he said, how do you explain this? How do you explain that you beat the best team that's won it 5 times in a row already, and you guys were the underdogs and none of us really liked you, and is what he was saying. We didn't really want you to win. But how do you explain it? And the coach, Doug Peterson, blurts out without hesitation, he says, I give all the glory and the honor to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And everybody in my house was off the couch, and they were up and screaming and clapping. Glorifying God is what we are about. The first question in the Westminster Catechism is about glorifying God and enjoying Him forever. In John 3:8, Jesus tells Nicodemus, the wind blows wherever it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you don't know where the wind is coming from, and so it is with everyone born of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit does the work of God in the world, but the Holy Spirit is not at our beck and call. The Holy Spirit does things according to the purposes of God for the glory of God, not because you say, gimme. The Spirit is not a genie in the bottle. We don't rub the bottle and the Spirit comes out and says, what may I do for you? You have 3 wishes. It doesn't work like that. The Spirit works according to God's plans, God's desires. And we need to learn to be working with God's plan, working according to His will, to see Him glorified. Back to the video, the Jedi Master tells Luke the problem. Only different in your mind. You must unlearn what you have learned. Sometimes we need to take a fresh look at what we've learned from the Scriptures and unlearn it because we didn't learn it the right way or we didn't learn it all. With God, nothing is impossible. We have to unlearn that physics tells us that if we step off the balcony, we're going to hit the floor. Physics tells us that mountains just don't lift up and throw themselves in the sea, yet Jesus said that these things are possible, and He said, you'll be able to do greater things than I have done. And then Luke says, I'll try. And Yoda pounces on him. And he says, try not. Do or do not. There is no try. And doesn't that sound a little bit like what we read in James? Believe it. We have to learn to pray in accordance with God's will and unlearn the desire to pray for what we will to come to pass. The Scriptures are the source for us to learn about God's will, for it is there that God speaks most clearly to us, there in the words. And what are the words of the prayer we speak each week in every church practically around the world? Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, there's one last component to talk about in regards to prayer, and that is faith. Faith is defined as complete trust or confidence in someone. Hear that key at the end? Not in a thing, but in a someone. The Scripture defines faith in Hebrews 11:1 as the assurance of things that are hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. So let's continue with the video for a moment.
I don't believe it.
That is why you fail.
James 1:6, verse 7 says, "But let him ask in faith, with no doubting. For the one who doubts is like the wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. For that person must not suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord." If we are praying for our will to be done, there is always the possibility of disappointment because our expectations will not be met. But if we are praying that the Father's will be done, that He would be glorified, we can never be disappointed because His purposes will always be accomplished. We read earlier Malachi chapter 3, verses 6 to 10. And God says in that, "Test me in this, and see if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing until there is no more room to receive it." Why is God making such statements if He is not willing to fulfill them? Now, before we get all excited that we can go home today and pray for the winning numbers in the lottery, that's not exactly according to God's will. But if we are praying for things according to God's will, look out, God is going to do marvelous things for us. But in the spiritual realm, in His realm, not in what we want necessarily. If we pray, "Lord, fill this place, bring people to the Lord," we're going to see people come to Christ. On Pentecost, 3,000 in one day. That's what God is talking about. Not riches, not possessions. He's talking about things that really matter in the eternal sense. I love that last little line there. As Luke is witnessing his spacecraft floating serenely out of the water over to the land, and it sets down light as a feather, and he's standing under it, and he's walking around, and he's looking up, and he stumbles over to Yoda, and he goes, "I don't believe it." And Yoda says to him, "That is why you fail." May we not doubt the power of our God to do tremendous things for our church, for our walk with Him in Christ, that we might grow deep. Test Him in this. Ask Him for these things, that you may be blessed and that He may be glorified in all things. Amen. Well, we're going to enter into prayer time. And I hope that as we enter into prayer time, we have a different outlook on why we're going to prayer right now. That is to seek the glory of God, to seek that He be lifted high. So let us join in prayer together. We have a lot of things to remember. The Ogg family, the Hayden family, the Comer family, Stefan, and the things going on down in Florida. Lots of things to remember. Things in which God can be glorified and God can move in lives. So let's pray, believing that God will bless and glorify Himself. Join me in prayer. O Lord our God, magnificent one, You whose power caused the universe to come into existence by a mere word. You who raised up Your Son, Jesus Christ, to take away the sin of the world, to do the impossible, to restore the broken relationship between us and Yourself. So many wonderful things that You have done down through the ages that are recounted throughout Your Word. Father, let us be inspired. Let us be motivated by Your Holy Spirit alone to seek the things above, to seek Your will. That, Lord, we might go forth to bring the good news to a world we know is desperately hurting, desperately in need. Father, we were so clearly reminded of that this week in Florida. And Lord, it is close to home and close to our hearts in that our brother Stefan, Lord, is in the midst of it. And Father, we come to You and ask that You be glorified. That, Lord, You be lifted up, that You be the source of comfort, that You be the source of power and wisdom and insight to comfort the grieving, Lord, to heal the injured, to restore broken families, to raise up Your church to be the solution to the problem, to be a witness to the world that the true solution is You. O Lord our God, You are so marvelous. Father, touch those families here at Manoa that have been going through difficult times these past few weeks, Lord. The Hayden family, the Ogg family, Lord. The Comer family. Father, we ask for those who are sick, those who are injured, those needing surgery, that you be with them. That, Lord, we might see your power move in great ways. That we might praise your name as you touch each and every need here at the church. And Father, forgive us for our neediness. Forgive us when we come and think only of what we want. Remind us, Father, that you already have told us that you will give us our daily bread. And Father, you gave us that wonderful prayer to remind us, Lord, of what you are already at work doing. And so, Father, we pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Hear now the benediction. Now unto him who is able to do abundantly above and beyond all that we could ever think or imagine, according to the power of the Holy Spirit that is within us, to work all these things out, to the glory and the majesty of God. Amen. May you go forth and have a blessed week, everyone. We come into your presence and we ask you to come into ours through your Spirit this morning, to speak to our hearts of your power, to make us aware of what you wish to do in our lives, how you wish to bless this church, this community. Father, may it be your words that are heard this morning, and may it be your power by which they are carried out. In Jesus' name, amen. 5 young college students decided to travel into London one Sunday afternoon so that they could hear the famed preacher Charles Spurgeon speak. While waiting for the doors of the church to open, the students were greeted by a man who asked them, "Gentlemen, let me show you around. Would you like to see the heating plant of this church?" Now, they were not particularly interested, being a rather hot day in July, and there was no such thing as air conditioning at that time, but they didn't want to offend the stranger, so they consented. The young men were taken down into the church and down a stairway into the basement. They paused for a moment before a closed door as their guide turned and whispered to them, "This is our heating plant." And then the stranger quietly opened the door. As the students gazed in amazement through the open door, they were surprised to see that instead of pipes and a boiler, they saw instead 700 people gathered in a large room. Every head was bowed in prayer, seeking a blessing on the service that was soon to begin in the auditorium above. Softly, the gentleman closed the door and then introduced himself. It was none other than Charles Spurgeon. A number of years ago, a friend of mine was called to leave Philadelphia and assist the pastor of a 1,000-member church in California. The impressive thing about this church was not that it had 1,000 members, but that 850 of its members regularly attended a midweek Bible study. Yet according to a study by the Barna Research Group, a Christian research outfit that tracks spiritual trends in the church, the average evangelical church only manages to introduce 1.7 people to Christ each year out of every 100 people who attend. I don't know who the 0.7 is, but I hope he's got at least arms and legs. Now, based on that finding, it appears that churches are barely able to replace those they lose. And this statistic was published in 1992. Imagine what the rate is now. There is no doubt that given the choice, churches would rather be like one of the two I've mentioned than the one resembling the Barna statistic. So where are the crowds of new believers in Christ? Where are the baptisms into the body of Christ? Where are the vibrant prayer meetings? Hint, hint. Prayer concert, March 10th. Where is the life-transforming power of God in our churches from the pulpit? Got to watch out for myself there. Preaching is useless. Activities are useless. Programs are useless unless lives are being forever changed for the kingdom of God. If we don't pray and do not have an appetite for God, what will it matter that we come here on a Sunday morning? The quality of a ministry is not measured by the size of the building, the number of individuals in attendance, its services, or the wonderful work they're doing with the poor or the destitute, but by the spiritual transformation that takes place in the lives of the people and the surrounding community. Now, one of the main strategies employed by the enemy against God's people is to whisper in their ear, "Don't call on God. Don't ask. You're only bothering Him. Don't depend on God to do great things. You'll get along just fine if you rely on your own strength, your own cleverness. Besides, you don't really think you're worthy of such power, do you?" And sadly, that tactic is quite effective. The Word of God describes a different strategy. Turn to Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. Ephesians 3, 14 through 21. "For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of His glory, He may grant you to be strengthened with power through His Holy Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God." And here is my most famous favorite verse in the Bible. "Now to Him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we could possibly ask or imagine, according to that power which is already within us." Could that really happen here? 700? 850? 1,000? "Besides, we've prayed before and nothing happens." But what kind of prayers were they? What were they asking for? How were those prayers prayed? And how often? Prayer is the single most important and powerful activity a Christian can engage in. The enemy is never frightened by our human efforts. In fact, he encourages us to engage in them often. Because he knows when we do it, we're going to make a mess. But he is, however, terrified of God's power at work through us. He knows he's in for a severe beating when we lift up our hearts to God and ask for the Holy Spirit's power to be at work in our lives. Those people in the two churches mentioned earlier were on fire for the Lord and experiencing his power at work in their lives. Just imagine if this church did something powerful like that with God's help. Just imagine coming to Manoa on a Sunday morning and not being able to get here because there's such a traffic jam in this neighborhood, there's nowhere to move. You'd have to park over there, maybe in the parking lot behind Acme, and leave your car there and stream over here on foot because there's just too many people. One more story of a church that did just that. The pastor of this church had reached the end of his rope. He wasn't a seminary-trained guy. In fact, his father-in-law, who was a pastor, asked him to take over this little rundown church with barely 25 people in attendance. And while on a fishing trip, on a crowded boat, he broke down before the Lord in prayer and cried out, "Lord, I haven't gone to seminary. I'm working in the middle of the city with people dying on every side from drugs, disease, materialism, crime, and all the rest. If the gospel is so powerful..." And there he stopped because he just simply couldn't continue. The tears choking him, his emotions so strong. And then quietly, in words not heard by ear, but deep within his spirit, God spoke to him and said, "If you will lead my people to pray and call upon my name, you will never lack for something fresh to preach. I will supply all the money that is needed, and you will never have a building large enough to contain the crowds I will send in response." The pastor returned to his church the very next Sunday. And he made the following announcement to his congregation. He said, "From this day on, the prayer meeting will be the barometer of our church. What happens in the prayer meeting will be the gauge by which we will judge success or failure, because that will be the measure by which God blesses us. If we call upon the Lord, he has promised in his word to answer and pour out his spirit among us. But if we don't call upon the Lord, he has promised nothing. Nothing at all. It's as simple as that. The future will depend upon our times of prayer. This is the engine that will drive our church, and I hope that you will come along with me." After finishing this speech, a visitor stood up and made his way to the front of the church. He claimed to be a minister from Australia, and he made the following comment to the people gathered there that morning. He said, "I heard what your pastor said. Here is something to think about. You can tell how popular a church is by who comes on Sunday morning. You can tell how popular the preacher is by who comes on Sunday night. But you can tell how popular Jesus is by who comes to the prayer meeting." With that said, the visitor turned and walked out of the church, never to be seen again. Yeah, he was on his way back to heaven. As though blowing oxygen upon the dying embers of a fire, the members of a broken-down church in a roughshod inner-city neighborhood began to pray faithfully and consistently, week after week, for God to pour out His Spirit upon them in a powerful way. And today, the congregation of the Brooklyn Tabernacle is 10,000 members strong and filled with converted prostitutes, pimps, drug addicts, and homeless people, as well as wholesome families. They made a tremendous impact on their neighborhood and changed lives forever. Their musical ministry alone is Grammy Award winning and has touched people around the world, all because they called upon the power of God through prayer and didn't try to do it themselves. Again, the question, can it happen here? Yes. Fresh power can be given to you here in this place. The only thing that is necessary is to ask. To simply say, God, will you shower us with your Spirit, with your power? God, will you transform us? And will you use us to reach out? Let's look at that passage from Ephesians one more time. For this reason, I bow my knees. Do you notice where he starts? On his knees before God. And this is what he's asking for, that God, according to the riches of his glory, may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit, that we've already learned is inside of us, in our inner being, dwells within us. So that Christ may also dwell in your hearts through faith, that you may be rooted and grounded in love and have the strength to comprehend, to understand just how much power is there. Just how powerful your God is. He says it surpasses knowledge. And then that verse, my favorite verse in the Scriptures. Now unto Him who is able. Not incapable. Able to do abundantly above and beyond all that we could possibly think or imagine. And you all know I'm a sci-fi nut. I've got an imagination. I read comic books. I can think of some weird stuff, gang. But God is infinitely far above our abilities to be able to think and to do on our behalf. Just remember, never confuse the power within you as the power you possess, because it's all about Him. We must humble ourselves and go to Him. That famous passage about prayer, which says, if my people will what? Humble themselves and pray, God will show up. We're about to enter into a season of great change for this church. In a few short weeks, our new pastor is going to be here to preach to you, to meet with you. We are preparing for his arrival and praying that God will bless him abundantly, above and beyond all that we can think or imagine, to bless you and this church, to do great things for his kingdom, for his glory and his honor. As we learned, when we pray in Jesus' name, if we forget that, to ask that God be glorified, the prayer is ineffective. And so let's pray that God will be glorified by his power in this place. Amen. As we come into our prayer time this morning, I had one of those God moments on the way over here. I've been in contact with Stefan every week on Thursdays when I drive over to the office here at the church. He and I engage in some time. He had a great little phrase he used with that. He said, redeeming the time, because it's mind-numbingly boring driving an hour down an open road with nothing going on. And so he and I spend time talking about Manoa, talking about the people here, his vision for the church, and then we pray with each other. And it's just awesome. But Thursday, my heart was just going out to him because he's in the midst of this Parkland shooting down in Florida. He's dealing with the kids and the families and gathering the churches together to minister. And as he got on the phone, he was just so exhausted. I felt so embarrassed that I'd even bothered him for our weekly phone call. And my heart was just going out to him as he's just losing strength trying to deal with this great burden. And so as we were driving over this morning, I just happened to flip on the radio and I had a USB in the radio to play a collection of songs that I have. And one of these songs came on that just hit me. And these were the words of that song. There's a new day dawning, can't you see? Just open up your heart and believe. When the sky opens up to rain on you, I'll be there with open arms to cover you. Don't give up now. There's nothing that I wouldn't do. I'm never giving up on you. Lord speaking those words to me, and I just broke down in tears, thinking about, God, may you come down on the people down there. May you come down on Stefan. May you lift them up, Lord. Let them hear and feel those arms that you talk about in this song, that you would never give up on them. And then as we sang, the first two songs has those same words in it. Never give up. And Jodine and I didn't talk about what song she was going to pick. She went by the title, Power. Never giving up had nothing to do with power. That's another God thing. God loves to do these little things for us, to show us his power and his might in the day, to let us know what's going on, to let us know that he's there. And so as we go to prayer, let us remember Stefan, who is coming to be our new pastor. Pray for him that he is welcomed just as you have welcomed me, that he is empowered by the Spirit to come in here and to lead this church into a new era of growth in Christ. Pray that he is strengthened and his strength is renewed like the eagles, to help these families who are facing some pretty devastating times ahead as they grapple with injuries, as they grapple with death, and as they grapple with that question, why? God does indeed have something awesome that's coming. So join with me in prayer, and let's not forget those in our own congregation who are bearing burdens. I know this has been a tough struggle the last couple of months for a lot of people with many things. But when the sky opens up to rain on you, God is there with his open arms. And let's pray for that comfort and healing. Join me in prayer, would you? Gracious Father above, perfect Father, the one who never lets go of us, the one who is always there beside us. And Lord, sometimes we just don't have words. Sometimes the things we face just seem to be overwhelming. But Lord, your word always encourages us with one word, trust. Trust in spite of what we cannot see, in spite of what we cannot understand. Trust in me. Father, help us in our trust. Help us to keep putting one foot in front of the other and following you no matter what comes our way. Knowing that if you choose not to take the storm out of our lives, Father, you are going to walk with us through it. You are going to lead us to those green pastures, beside those still waters. Father, these trials that we face, Lord, are sometimes to help our faith to grow even deeper in you, to test our resolve to trust you. Lord, by that power that is within us, strengthen us to never give up on you as you never give up on us. Father, you have something wonderful in store for your people here at Manoa. You are preparing it even now. Even in the midst of their trials and wondering and questions. Father, we pray your blessings upon Stefan Bomberger, upon his family, upon his community, his churches, and especially to those young people he's ministering to in the depths of this darkness, Father. This terrible deed. Let your light break forth. Let your power shower them. That, Father, in the midst of this, new life in Christ may sprout. New believers may grow. That a world that is cynical, a world that is more interested in the politics, might see how you comfort, how you supply the needs, how you come beside the people, how they are your primary concern in the midst of this. May that be the light that shines in the darkness we see in this world. And Father, may you use us. May you use us in powerful ways here at Manoa to pray and to lift up these young people. To lift up Stefan and his family, the churches that have rallied around them. And may you use us, Father, to reach out to the Kevins that come across our lives every day. To reach out to those within our congregation who need just a kind word, just a word saying, we're praying for you. A hug in the hallway. Open our eyes, Father, to see those around us. That we might be your tangible blessing to them. Father, continue to bless us with all the events coming as we enter into Easter season. Bless, Lord, the prayer concert. Bless the all-day leadership meeting. Bless, Lord, Stefan on the 18th. Bless the Easter journey. Bless Maundy Thursday, and especially the day of all days, Easter, when you rose from the dead and conquered death and showed to us that eternal life in you is possible. Father, thank you for your love for us. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for the prayer you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, as on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Receive now the benediction, and remember, don't disappear afterwards. Now unto him who is able to present you faultless before the throne of grace, by the mercy of his Son, Jesus Christ, may he send you forth in great power to share the good news of the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace after the congregational meeting, and have a blessed week.